authorities, the professors, and classmates. My name is Daniel Espinosa, former president of the Denver Energy Club, and for me it's a real honor to be here to support the Mellon Speaker Series today. So as you know, the Mellon Speaker Series has been created in 2006 in order to provide students great connections with CEOs and management experts. So the event of today is sponsored by the Organizational Leadership Club, by the Denver Energy Club, and by the Carnegie Mellon Electricity Industry Center. So today, we come to the participation of Mr. Porges. So let me make a brief resume of his extensive and successful professional career. Mr. David Porges, Dave for his friends, holds an MBA from the Stanford University. Also, he has a degree in industrial engineering from Northwestern University. Currently, he is part of the board of Rand Corporation, also from Carnegie Mellon University, and the Pittsburgh Cultural Trust. So particularly, Mr. Porges has an extensive career in the field of oil and gas and financial services. He joined EQT in 1998 as a chief financial officer, and in 2007, he was promoted to be the chief operating officer, and today is the chief executive officer of EQT Corporation. Before working in EQT, he also worked for other important companies, such as Westport Resources as a CFO. Also, he was part of the Bankers Trust Company. So he was chief of financial services, manager of acquisition, structured finance, and risk advisor. Also, he worked 7 years in ExxonMobil Corporation, in Texas, and Australia. So please join me in welcoming Mr. David Porges.
Thank you. Your comments about the noise reminded me that one of the presentations that I gave to investors, which is just an investor relations type presentation, in one of these big ballrooms in New York City a couple of years ago, they had chairs that were of the movable variety, not these fixed chairs that you have in the auditorium. And they were making a lot of noise removing the chair. So it wasn't potato chips, but it was removing the chairs. And you always get introduced there by the equity analyst that covers the company. And I kind of joked with the crowd as that was happening that he had promised me a standing room only crowd. I just didn't realize he had to remove chairs to achieve that. But this is a great turnout. Thank you. There's a lot of different ways to make a presentation. I don't know if at Tepper they give you any hints on it. I think it would be great if they did, but I can offer advice on business school educations if anyone's interested, and I won't if they're not. But I used to hear that there was a version, I don't know if it's true or not, because I was never in the Army, but it was referred to as the Army Tell'em Outline. I don't know if you've ever heard of the Army Tell'em Outline. And it goes like this, and it's not a bad notion when you're making a presentation. Tell them what you're going to tell them. Tell them. Tell them what you told them. I'm going to do the first two of that because I think it's good to know what's coming. So I'm going to speak for several minutes, and after that we'll go to Q&A and we can go in whatever direction you want. But what I'm going to do during the slide parts, which are really designed just as props, and that's another topic because I'd kind of chatted with your dean that I don't believe in walking bullet point through bullet point. I scold people in our company when they try to do that. But I do think it's helpful to have a prop. I'm going to give you a little bit about our journey, my journey, and then ours from an EQT perspective. So it'll be a bit about me and then about the company where I've been CEO for 7 years, though I'm stepping down at the end of this month and I'll be executive chair for a year after that. And then just some general thoughts that I have as I'm reflecting on my career and my time at school, including at business school. So we'll start with my own journey. I am from the south side of Chicago, and you know, it won't go this slow the whole way. I'm a Cub fan. I've got, you can, from a distance, the C you could decide it means CMU, but it actually says Cubs. So this was a good past few months from my perspective. For me, it was public school all the way through high school. Neither of my parents went to college. Frankly, that's influenced a lot of my own philanthropic priorities over the course of time and the importance of education to give folks truly equal opportunities. But I then did go to a private university. I went to Northwestern, as was covered in my introduction. I decided I wanted to go straight to business school. I was told that that didn't happen then, but the reality was for some folks it did happen. And I went to what we'll all call, for the purposes of today's discussion, the Carnegie Mellon of the West. And I decided that what I wanted to do was to be involved in management, and I wanted to learn how to manage things. And the way one would define management would be to manage people and to also be responsible for a P&L, or profit and loss. At that time, some of the major oil companies, and I did have an interest in energy. And to put this in perspective, I entered business school in 79, graduated in 81. The oil shocks occurred in the 70s, including in the late 70s. So energy was a hot topic at that point. A very good friend of mine in college thought nuclear engineering was the way to go, and it may still be, but from what I can read from the newspapers here, 40 years later, it still isn't quite, but it's, you know, still has some promise. But I picked oil and gas, and it just happens that one of the people I was interviewing with had graduated from the very same department of Northwestern as I had attended, even though it typically only had about 15 graduates a year. And he was very excited because he was getting transferred overseas. So even though they're interviewing for all of Exxon, it was Exxon there at that point, the merger, I guess you'd call it, with Mobil happened later. And incidentally, folks would comment about what a long name, you know, Exxon Mobil. And the response from Exxon people was, well, the Mobil is silent. So. At that point, they had these regional operating companies, including Australasia, being headquartered in Houston. And this guy who interviewed me was just about to get transferred to Japan. And what he sold me on was, if things go well, you will get a chance to go overseas, where you will then be managing folks and managing P&L. That is, in fact, what happened. So the second half of my 7 years with Exxon was in Australia, mainly Sydney, some Melbourne, and it was managing people. So I had a P&L, and I was managing people, and then I got transferred back to the US before I turned 30. So in my 20s, I was doing that, and I thought that was great, but I viewed myself as reasonably numerate, and yet this was all in kind of operational areas. And it was a time where what were then called the Section 20 banks, which were the commercial banks trying to be in investment banking, were trying to get a foothold. And they needed to find some advantage versus what were then called the bulge bracket firms, the Goldman Sachs and folks like that. So they were looking for folks with energy expertise in their M&A groups. So when Exxon decided to transfer me back to the US after I'd been in Australia for my 3-year stint, and it was either gonna be transferred back to the US or transferred to another country. So they transferred me back to the US. I decided this is a good time to leave. And I spent the next 11 years in a variety of positions, all focused on the energy industry at Bankers Trust. Bankers Trust at that time, now they've been owned by Deutsche Bank for more than 15 years now, but they were a leader in derivatives. And at one point they decided they wanted to push the idea of using derivatives to influence structured finance. And I actually got involved in doing a fair bit of that. That resulted in us having a joint venture with Shell, or one who actually were advised Shell and another company. That group reported to me that was in Houston. The guy who headed that group in Shell got offered the chance to be a CEO up in Pittsburgh, and he asked if I'd come with him as CFO. And he actually became a friend of mine. We go for runs together. Now, neither of us have good enough knees to be able to run, but runs and bike rides and stuff like that. So I got to know him. So that's the Bankers Trust lesson, is I found out about the bank's interests and people with industry experience from an Exxon colleague who had gone to join them. I'd mentioned the connection that got me from business school to my first job. And in this case, it was somebody who had been a client and a friend who was not really all that good financially, but I mean, people in his position really wouldn't be, who was getting a CEO job for which he was well qualified, and he wanted a CFO who he knew because he wanted folks that he trusted. So that's each one of the moves had some amount of opportunism. It wasn't just applying for a job blindly and hoping. It was some type of a connection. And then maybe that's a lesson to keep in mind is do be wary of a couple of things or cognizant of a couple of things. One is that you should be trying to construct a career, not in neat building blocks, but have some basic notion of what direction you want to head. And try to make sure that you're gaining the skills and the attributes. And of course, attributes could be otherwise referred to as less maybe kindly as resume building, that would help you get where you want to go. You're going to change your view on exactly where you want to go, but some basic notion of what you're trying to accomplish and trying to make sure that the next step is somehow or another helping you with that, I think is beneficial. I knew I wanted to leave banking for a long time. I'm surprised I spent 11 years there. I felt I'd be better on the other side of it. So I showed up, and this will show, I guess, in 98 it was, got to EQT. I'll let you read that. But at the time I joined, we were maybe 600 to a million to a billion dollar equity cap company. At the core of it was a utility called Equitable Gas Company. And it was kind of a broken company. On a split adjusted basis, it was traded at, to give you an idea, it was trading at 8 and change when my predecessor joined the company. I joined a month later, it was already down to 7. It had already dropped more than 10% on the appointment of a early 40s CEO. Why would investors sell it off? Because they thought we were worth more dead than alive, right? They thought the company would get sold and they'd have a win. You hire in a 40-something CEO, it means you're not being sold. A 40-something CEO and a just 40-year-old CFO, you're not being sold. They didn't like that. And the stock drifted down to the point where it was, within a few months, we were trading at 5 and change. And there was a lot of restructuring work that we had to do. You can see there we've become one of the top 5 natural gas producers in the US. But this kind of gives you a sense of that of the company, which has a long storied history. It was started essentially by George Westinghouse. He really bought something out of bankruptcy that had a utility license. You needed that. And you can see there the dates where it changed its name to Equitable Resources. We eventually changed to EQT Corp. Went from being this tiny company to being more in the $10 to $12 billion equity cap variety that we are now. A lot of restructuring that we had to do when we joined the company, and he was very good at that. Got rid of, a lot of people weren't really signing up for the program, so they left, and very few people remain now who were there at the company when my predecessor and I joined in 1998. But we thought the number one thing we had to do was clean things up. What we didn't do so much on his watch, because it just didn't play as much to his strengths, was financial engineering. Now, flipping back to Bankers Trust for a second, one of the most valuable lessons there, and it stuck with me to the point where I'm sure I bore a number of my current colleagues at EQT with it, is as much as you can think about discount rates and rates of return, et cetera, you can pull back to maybe a more basic concept that you will get better returns. You will get a lower cost of capital if you give investors cash flow streams whose attributes match what they are looking for. So if you can think of whatever the cash flow streams as having a variety of your own attributes, and you pull those strands apart, and you try to sell those strands of cash flows. A lot of people have made a lot of money on Wall Street basically doing that. We did it a little bit with the company by selling off the assets that didn't fit with what our goal was and buying more in the areas that we thought did play to our strengths, where we did have competitive advantages, assets that helped us enhance those competitive advantages. And we also took some of the streams of cash flow from our midstream, which means really pipeline business, and put them into master limited partnerships. And to give you an idea, that's only in my 7 years as CEO. So in 7 years of CEO, there were multiple billion dollars of sales of assets, multiple billion dollars of acquisitions. I believe you can count them up there, and maybe I'll be proven to be wrong, but I think it's 8 equity offerings in 7 years. 2 of them were IPOs, 2 MLPs. We took the master limited partnership The fact that it's called master means it's public. For those of you who aren't familiar with that, it's a limited partnership that's public is called a master limited partnership. It has the so-called incentive distribution rights invested with the general partner, meaning they get they're incentivized to increase cash flow, and they get paid more as cash flows go up. We got to the point where we decided to take that general partner public. That's the other, should be up there someplace, EQGP IPO. That's what the GP IPO is. And pretty much got to the point where I thought, and incidentally, a lot of those drops are actually sales. The way you stimulate the growth in these MLPs is you take assets that fit and you sell them from the sponsor company, in our case EQT, to the MLP. You sell them, the MLP has its own board of directors. Frankly, it's the majority are from the sponsor company. A minority, though, are independent directors, and those independent directors are the only members of the so-called conflicts committee that determine whether a transaction between the parent and the MLP is a reasonable transaction. So those drops, that's what that is. When you're dropping, you're selling from the parent company to the MLP, and you see there's several of those in there. The EQM, I think we took that public in 2012 at about $21 a share, so it's trading at about, our unit, and it's trading about 80 now. 5 years later, and EQGP, since it went out when the interest rates were at the lowest, it was only at about 27, and it's trading a little bit above the IPO price. That was in 2015, we took that public. But I got to the point where I thought most of the financial engineering heavy stuff at the company had been done. Financial strategy is always going to be important at any company, but there was a period of time at EQT where I felt it had an outsized importance. There were a lot of things on our tick list, things that we could do to create shareholder value. And frankly, the thing I'm probably proudest of at my tenure as CEO is over that 7 years, the market has been down. So our market, EQT's, the energy market, as commodity prices, as we're a bit of a victim of our own success, commodity prices have dropped a fair bit over that period of time. So our peer group is down about 7% per annum over those 7 years, and EQT is up about 7% per annum over those 7 years. So that's the stuff that I'm proudest of, is that in a market where the values were trending downward, because investors clearly thought we can continue to have high volumes at these high prices, or growing volumes at high prices, and that didn't turn out to be true, so it wound up being, that there were headwinds from an equity perspective, our stock price still has gone up over that period of time. Certainly a lesson from that, from our company, as we talk about, if there's a lot of technological improvements such that most of the members of the industry believe that they can make an above market return at a given price, at the current market price, the current market price is too high. Right? I mean, that's, in retrospect, that's one of the things I wish we had focused on, is too many of us are making too much money at this price. This can't be the right price. It's a long lead time, capital intensive business. The lags simply haven't caught up with us. So I would encourage you, if you, any business you're involved in the future, if you find yourself in that situation, it looks like a bunch of market participants are making a lot of money at a particular price, maybe you shouldn't make a lot of plans that are based on that being the long-term price. But it could be that the overall, if the cost structure is dropping, unless it's just for you in a very protected way, then the prices are going to drop too. But anyway, we got to the end of the period where I thought financial engineering was particularly important, so I decided I want to go on and do other things. And you were told in the intro about a lot of the other stuff that I'm interested in. One of the things that my wife and I want to do also, though, is we want to travel more with our kids. We have a 13-year-old and a 12-year-old. They're onto their third passports each. So, there's 5 year things. We've been going to Europe every year since the youngest one was a year and a half. And I've wanted to spend more time overseas. So we've actually rented a flat in Chelsea this summer. So as soon as they get out of the Chelsea neighborhood of London, we negotiated with our girls, and they wanted to go to an English-speaking place first. My wife was born in Argentina, and she's obviously very comfortable with Spanish, but what we negotiated was, okay, we'll start with England. So we rented a flat for this coming summer in Chelsea, and the notion is that we'll do Spain the year after, and then we'll see where we go. We also love Italy, We've obviously been to South America a fair bit to see my wife's relatives. And I want to be involved in some of the other not-for-profit stuff that I'm involved in. I've tended to give my own philanthropic money to education. It's tended to emphasize folks whose parents didn't go to college. I'm not saying those are the only ones who deserve it. I think we all deserve a good education if it's appropriate, an education that's appropriate to our capabilities. I didn't even know they call those people first generation. There's a name for it. I described it. Somebody said, well, we call those first generation students. So I was a first generation student. As a result, I kind of favor those. I think it's great that a lot of other individuals favor other approaches to education, and hopefully there's enough people willing to give back that all sorts of educational initiatives are funded. So I now just want to give you a few of the lessons that I've learned along the way, and then I'm running a little over the 15 minutes that you mentioned for prepared remarks, but I don't know if I want to, I don't know if I want to cover the first one first, so I'm going to skip it. I got a management coach, as I told the group that I met with earlier, and one of the best lessons that he gave us, and I think this would apply in your career, something maybe for you to bear in mind, and this guy, his name is Marshall Goldsmith, as you can see up there. You can read that, but this time I will say it. What got you here won't get you there, right? The skill set that helped you succeed in the position you're in is highly unlikely to be the same skill set and the same attributes that will help you succeed in the next. Like, you don't want to be an exhibit in there's a book kind of more of our era they probably wouldn't have heard of called the Peter Principle. You know, of people naturally rising to their level of incompetence. You know, what a happy thought that we naturally rise to the level of our incompetence. But I think this gets more at it, that there are different skill sets that you need as you become a manager. I do think it would be great if business schools taught more about how to manage. To give you a few, and maybe you do already, but you know, a few tools to have in the toolkit. So it's not just the basic of what accounting and marketing and finance and then classes in entrepreneurship and innovation. I think all of that is great. Incidentally, one of my favorite memories of business school, the things that I think I learned the most from, were any projects that involved interaction with other, let's just say other human beings. It was really interaction with other students. Group negotiating things where there's a case and the group I'm in is negotiating, if you will, against another group, and you each get your own version of the case. It's not the same. You don't see what the other person's perspective is. You know, you're gleaning that over the course of time. So negotiation, but doing that in kind of a live way. And another fascinating one, I thought, where the professor said, you're writing a memo to the CEO. There's five of you. You can write however many memos you want and have it be as long as you want. However, I'm only going to grade papers that have all five team members' names on the memo, and do make sure you put it on the first page. Because the first thing I'm going to do is tear off anything behind the first page and throw it away. So, one page memo has to be all the members of the group. Oh my goodness, the debates amongst a bunch of, say, type A personalities, and the wordsmithing that goes on, but a great form of interaction. So I thought that was great, but learning these different skills to work with groups, be good as an individual contributor, be good as a manager, being a manager of people who are managers is yet another skill set. One thing they also told us in business school, informally, the professors never would have said that, the dean never would have said it, but the students would say, don't make work-life trade-offs until you're 40, is what they would say. And you know, I think you should decide what you want to think about when it comes to work-life trade-offs. Because that, don't make a career choice where everyone's working 100-hour weeks and you're thinking you're going to have all the weekends off, right? If you go to a position where that's suitable, or if you are willing to put in those kind of hours for a while, make sure you've got some way of extracting yourself from that, right? So maybe every birthday or something, you tell yourself, I'm going to think about what my work-life balance is, or I get to a particular birthday and I will think about what I want to do next. So trying to make work-life balance decisions that are inconsistent with the culture of the organization you're part of is not a winning proposition. You know, you've got to either change your approach or change organizations, you know, and get one that is more suited. So your fit with an organization often is as much cultural as it is actual skill sets. There's a basic level of skills you need, but then there's a cultural fit, and work-life balance is part of that cultural fit. So another quote that I love from, and if you aren't familiar with the late John Gardner, I encourage you to look him up. Actually, I'm going to tell you about John Gardner before you read about that again. He was the first secretary of a department that was then called Health, Education, and Welfare. It didn't exist previously. President Johnson created it. It's now, of course, two, right? It's Health and Human Services and Education, but it was, John Gardner was the first out of it. He had retired already, he would say. He got called out of retirement to be that cabinet secretary. He retired from that. He wanted to get more active in community citizens stuff. So he founded a group called Common Cause. So he was the founder of Common Cause, and then he was also very instrumental at, in the early days, at least, of the Aspen Institute. And he wrote a number of books about self-renewal and kind of being aware of yourself. And I think self-knowledge is extremely important. But one of the things he commented on, which I think is fascinating, and there's loads of interesting quotes. If you look up a commencement speech, say, that he's got online, and you will find them, because he was asked to do a lot of commencement speeches. You don't have to read the book Self-Renewal. You can just read one of his speeches. I've kept one, frankly, and I've sent it off to various people. They probably wonder, who did this come from? Why are they, what's the message here? But so that bit that everyone wants to be interesting, but the advice is be interested, right? Don't try to be interesting, be interested. That's what keeps you vital and would keep you vital throughout your life. Frankly, it's one of the reasons I'm stepping down where I think it's extremely valuable what our company is doing now. It's just not quite as interesting to me as all the financial engineering. But I shouldn't be force-fitting the financial engineering because we've done that, right? It's not the right thing to do in our organization anymore. I love being involved at CMU. The RAND Corporation, if you're not familiar with that, what a fascinating organization that is. We get, I think I'm one of two members of their board who don't have a wiki page. So it's an extremely interesting group of folks, extremely interesting presentations that they give about the work that they're involved with. And actually, they've got an office right, they've got a Pittsburgh office right up on Fifth Avenue. And I think a number of people at CMU do interact with Susan Everingham and the other folks at RAND. So I love a lot of that. I like being involved in other aspects of education as well. But that would be some advice, is to be interested and make sure that no matter what you're involved in, you can be interested. And the final bit is a quote that I love. Actually, I love the whole speech. I was a little taken aback when I then saw it as a part of a trailer for a biopic that's coming out about the rapper Tupac. I mean, well, I wouldn't know his music to save. I don't even know if I'm pronouncing his name correctly, but his mom is giving him, mom is talking to him, and she's quoting from this same thing. And actually, it's from Shakespeare's play Hamlet. And there's a character, if you've read it, you're then familiar. Polonius is giving advice to his son Laertes, who's heading off overseas. Of course, Hamlet is, you know, this is all set in Denmark, and the son Laertes is heading off to France. And he gives him a speech, and it's got the old never a borrower nor a lender be type of, the clothes off befits the man. You've heard these phrases. It's all one speech. But this is my favorite part of it. This above all else, to thine own self be true. And you can read that. Don't let yourself get so sucked up in your career that you lose track of who you are, right? Be true to yourself, and if you're true to yourself, as this says, you can't not then be, you know, you'll be true to everybody else. You know, we'll translate it to American English of the 21st century. You know, you'll be true to everybody else. It'll also be true that you can't not be false to anybody, but that's like a triple negative, isn't it? Yeah. But that's my final bit of advice, is that know who you are and be true to that. Thank you for your time, and I'm happy to take questions. Should I just take them, or are you going to help me with identifying questions? If there's no questions, you know, I'm going to talk about the Cubs, so you really want to ask questions. Oh, geez, that's, at the risk of getting too personal, I was pretty involved with a woman in Australia when I was transferred to back to the U.S. And I decided as soon as I was transferred that I was going to go into banking, and I already had a lead for where I was going to do that. It's a little sad, but there were a number of business school classmates of mine at the CMU of the West who were married and who went into investment banking. None of those who went to Wall Street remained married. None. Now, there was one guy, he actually gets in the paper a fair bit, and I saw him at the again played in the Pro-Am, named Frank Quattrone. He was a classmate and friend who was very involved in technology banking. Well, actually still is. He's got his own firm. It's called Catalyst. And actually, Frank and I saw, he got tickets for he and I to see a Giants-Cubs playoff game in San Francisco, which was many years ago, and of course the Giants won and the Cubs lost. But Frank was from Philly and had gone to Wharton and then worked for a couple of years at Morgan Stanley on Wall Street, and he had had a longtime girlfriend. But he told them when they wanted to hire him to bring him back to New York that the only circumstance under which he was going back to New York, only circumstance under which he was staying with Morgan Stanley was that he stayed in San Francisco. And he said, well, we don't have an office there. And he said, well, I'll start an office. So he was married. He got married between years in business school, and he's remained married all these decades later. But the ones who went to Wall Street, it didn't happen. I remember on Sunday afternoons, sometimes when we get a cup of coffee out of, you know, those cheap coffee machines, now they've got the, you know, fancy ones, I'm sure. We take a break at maybe 6 in the evening on Sunday, and you're thinking about, you know, you worked on Sunday? Yeah, every Sunday. There was a rule of thumb. If the day ended in the letter Y, then we worked, you know, so. And we'd start calculating, and you would get up to, every week, it was over 100 hours of work. And if you do the math, there's just no time for anything else. And at that time, I remember reading I think Wall Street Journal talked about some associate or vice president or something at Goldman Sachs, or maybe it was Morgan Stanley, who said that the highlight of his month was the Saturday morning once a month when he got a haircut. Now, you're doing that because it's a means to an end. And I think a lot of the tech companies, it might be the same thing, right? You're doing that as a means to an end. So I broke up, you know, I decided, well, this isn't gonna work. So that was sad, but that's, you know, you had to make a decision on what it was gonna be. And actually, part of the reason I'm stepping down when I am is because my daughters are in 8th and 7th grades. And the things that we can do with them, for instance, spend a couple of months in overseas over the summer, are things that we can make them do now, but aren't going to be possible. There's a yeah, it stops. You can't. That's how the window is narrow. And spending, you know, having a full-time job and spending 2 months overseas aren't consistent, right? So this time, it's the decision is go in the other direction and value the family over the career. Because we think the window's open. Incidentally, the debate my wife and I have had about it is, at what age are we willing to let them go to the corner coffee shop? And she would say 30, you know. But in fact, in Squirrel Hill, they walk to the coffee shop now and thought, well, if it's a Chelsea neighborhood of London, is where we've got a flat. You can imagine what their first question was, you know, how close is the nearest Starbucks? But nowadays, you can find that on a map, you know, or some kind of an app or something. So they're at the age where they don't have to be attached to us every minute of every day, and yet they still kind of have to come along with us. So we're in that window where we think we can be influential, particularly influential in this formative stage of their lives. And that's, so those are two. I didn't see a lot of questions, so I thought I could give you two answers. Yes?
Yes, Derek Cole, Porges here. So you mentioned some of your work outside of EQT. I'm curious, building on Candace's question, too. How do you choose those activities, and then how does that add to, what does that bring into your functioning at the company?
The notion as you get even at a moderate level with a company, with some companies, with EQT it's certainly true, but it's true of many, is that they like folks to be able to, in the community, to be able to put a human face on the company. It's very difficult to dislike people intensely if you get along with them. I mean, dislike them because of you, but maybe that sounds odd. Dislike them because of the industry they're in if you get along with them. Natural gas is kind of funny. We went through a period of time during my career at EQT where we were the saviors. And then we get to a point where folks think we're almost the opposite. I mean, we're maybe not as bad as coal, but you know, it's an odd thing. But not in this community, not the folks I interact with through this. So that's been the benefit for the company, is they put a human face on the people in the company, and I think that's beneficial. I also think it's good to get outside your bubble. I mean, I think it's extremely difficult, especially in big companies, or as I was mentioning to some folks, but I think maybe just on a smaller discussion earlier, in Silicon Valley, the whole area can function as a bubble. You know, so even if you are with different companies, you all behave as if the world you have is the same world. I hope I'm not going to trip on this. The world you have is just is all that exists, right? That there is nothing else. Dealing with folks who are involved in the arts or involved in education helps subtly to challenge those priorities. And I think it helps you get a better sense of who you are. Now, as you get more senior, people want you to be more involved. So, unfortunately, you first start getting involved with things because they're the folks who ask you. And then you realize maybe that's not the stuff that is most interesting to me. But you almost have to start by getting involved in something, and it'll start expanding your network. And I just think it's so generally it's valuable for you to have a broader network, people who aren't in your bubble. Yes, sir. Not as much. It does decrease a fair bit as you get more senior. The financial stuff I've probably continued to use because our industry, like most non-financial industries, is not very advanced from a financial engineering perspective. So I think you can use a lot of, if you will, financial technology in those kinds of settings. But other than that, you almost find yourself struggling to understand the things that people are working on. I mean, we've actually decided to hire somebody from CMU, he just hasn't joined full time yet, who's a PhD, who will talk to some of our other, we've got a couple of other folks with PhDs or certainly advanced degrees in geophysics and things like that. And he talks about optimization models that he's got. And the notion that you can have a model using, and I think sometimes he even borrowed, you know, can find times where he can borrow space on a CMU computer or something. And you hit go or optimize or enter or whatever, and it takes 8 hours to come up with a solution. I thought, can you imagine? I mean, it takes 8 hours on an advanced computer to come up with a solution, but that's the level of optimization. Well, so we have even folks who are very highly skilled technically in one area or another who struggle to understand what he's talking about. So that could either be frustrating or it can actually be a little bit energizing. And I think most of our folks choose to view that as energizing. It's kind of consistent with be interested, you know, that they find that fascinating. But if you're in a situation where your company is looking for you to be the technology leader as you get more and more senior, I generally speaking, I don't think that's a good arrangement. I mean, you may be able to talk to some tech firms where they think that's the way it's worked, but generally speaking, I think you have to kind of accept that and maybe even embrace that there's, you know, if somebody's 95% as smart as you are and 95% as capable as you are, but they're spending 100% of their time on something, they're going to be better at it than you spending 10% of your time on it. And you just kind of accept that. So you actually get to the point where you want everyone who reports to you to be better at their job than you would be at their job. Right? I mean, you don't want, and that's one of the things as far as, you know, that quote from Marshall Goldsmith, one of his many quotes and so on, to, you know, what got you here won't get you there. don't try to be the smartest guy in the room. Actually, that's what he told me, and then he subsequently coached the guy who's in a couple of weeks takes over as my successor. Said, and I so I heard the advice, you know, a decade later, directed towards somebody else. You don't need to be the smartest guy in the room. You won. You won. You're the boss. They all know you won. There's only one person in this room who doesn't know you won. You. So accept you won. And I think embrace that, and then you get to the point where you actually kind of like it. So you want to stay up with it, but you kind of like the fact that these folks who report to you are better. Yes, sir. Well, my biggest example of that was that move from Exxon to Bankers Trust. I, again, decided that I'm a pretty numerate person, maybe not as numerate as you folks, but compared to the rest of the population, I'm pretty numerate. And I don't know anything about finance. And I went to business school. That's kind of weird to be numerate and have an MBA and not feel very good in finance. I didn't particularly like the finance classes, et cetera. So the opportunity to leverage off of what I did bring to the table, which was a deeper knowledge of the industry, was the approach that I took to getting into banking, which is what then helped me to learn more about finance. I remember going on a vacation right before I moved back from Australia to New York. So I'm up in a part of Australia called Cooktown. So it's way up if you're up with the York Peninsula. It's far northeast part of Australia where the guy who ran the camp he forgot when he came down to camp. He said, oh my goodness, I completely forgot. I don't have any shoes. I mean, because he never wore shoes. There was no need for shoes up at the camp that he was in. And I remember waking up one morning in one of these tents that had this kind of plywood, and you know, it was one of those deals, so you didn't pitch the tent, but it's canvas and stuff. And something is moving. You know, the bed is maybe about that high, and something's moving. It's about this big. And it's a python. And the head was already out the other end, and you know, the tail hasn't entered the tent yet. Yeah, it's like, I'm just gonna sit here and hope it goes, and it did. And in the midst of that, during my downtime, this friend of mine who worked at Bankers Trust then had sent me to Sydney, and then I brought up there with me stacks of Institutional Investor magazine. And here I am on vacation reading Institutional Investor magazine. I don't know if I actually learned anything specific, but at least I was starting to get the argo, you know, starting to understand the vernacular a little bit. But for me, it was, I guess, you know, backing up, it's take the strengths that I did have and try to use it to leverage into the stuff that I wanted to learn. You know, so I was at least bringing something to the table. So that's my example. I do fear that companies don't offer supervisory training as much as they should. I think when, Exxon did, you know, we would have role playing and they'd video you. If you're going to be a supervisor, you had to take a supervisory class within 6 months. We've tried to use that at EQT as well. Folks do seem to find it very valuable. I do think that's the toughest thing to do is to learn how to be an effective supervisor, a supervisor, and it's different at Sally. If you're a supervisor of professionals versus if you're a supervisor, you know, I never really was a supervisor of folks who were hourly employees, but I certainly have been a supervisor of folks on the one hand who were very ambitious from a career perspective, and on the other, folks who effectively just wanted to punch the clock. You know, and you have to accept, you're not gonna berating them for having that mindset, which is different from yours, is not constructive. So learning how to manage different types of people is a skill. I don't think most people come to it naturally. It is hard to do that if you're not given training. So business schools can do some of it. A lot of the messages resonate more though if you actually have that experience, you know, if kind of early on in your time as a supervisor. Incidentally, I would ask for that. The standard appraisal approaches, they become more and more informal over time. But typically they focus on what did you do that you were supposed to do and what did you fail to do that you were supposed to do. You know, it's almost like a list of what actions were you supposed to take or what were your results for the year. But then they also have their own version of here's what your strengths are and here's what your, we don't have weaknesses, of course, on those forms, needs for improvement or development needs, you know, that's what they all, you get kicked out of them if you call them a weakness. But to immediately follow up on that, if somebody says you need to work on this, how? You know, could I get some help working on it? Good supervisors actually like that, right? Not all your supervisors are going to be good, but good supervisors actually like that. Or it's colleagues around, especially more senior colleagues, you know, and tap their skill set and or their experiences on how you can learn that.
We have time for one more question.
We've got one over here, I know.
Yeah, hi David, my name is Salil. I'm curious about your experience working on the board for RAND.
Mm-hmm.
Specifically, you know, how do you measure performance for a nonprofit like RAND Corporation? And also, I assume that most of the board is composed of business leaders, so.
No, not entirely at RAND.
Oh, okay.
Look, we have a review session of the leader of RAND every, yeah, formal one every year. He sends out a memo. His name is Michael Rich, incidentally. And he's a very bright guy. His father was considered to be one of the originators of what was originally called the Skunk Works, which were, you know, developing stealth technology and things like that. To the point where actually, in one of our meetings in D.C., there was a general who had flown some of these stealth aircraft who started off his discussion by saying what an honor it was to be in the same room as the son of this visionary leader. But Michael does a great job, as a lot of these leaders will, of laying out what they were supposed to get done. And incidentally, a pet peeve of mine over my course of my career were folks who would describe the year only after the fact. It's way more valuable to suggest that you accomplish what you intended to accomplish if you establish what you intend to accomplish up front, right? So it's the first part of the bookend is, what are you trying to accomplish? Things do change, right? Everybody knows that, but here's what I tried to accomplish, here's what I did accomplish, right? So it's that. And then the other piece of it, incidentally, is it comes out in succession planning. And I've become a big believer, and actually there's another guy on the board at RAND, and he and I have both taken the lead. He probably has taken more of a lead. Just stepped down from his position at Sony Entertainment, as the chair of Sony Entertainment, because he's been mentoring a guy who's the CEO of a company called Snap Inc. And they're the ones who, you know, came up with Snapchat. So Michael Linton is a big believer in succession planning and management development and stuff like that. So we've gotten to the point where at RAND, every year they do also talk about succession planning. So you're looking at the senior most folks and talking about what they accomplished, didn't accomplish, their strengths, their needs for improvement, how you're going to go about improving. So it's a relatively formalized structure, but it doesn't take up much time to do that, right? So that's you've got that, and then hopefully that influences the more informal conversations. Incidentally, at RAND, a lot of the folks have a public policy background. There are certainly people who are business leaders. Michael Linton is an example, but there's other people who have got business positions. Actually, a guy who's really pushed a lot of that human resources stuff is a guy who was the Michael Gould, who's had been the head of Bloomingdale's. Yeah, I think it's actually his career now is to provide management to that kind of development and coaching for folks. But Harold Brown, who was the defense secretary under President Carter and had been the head of Caltech, he's on the RAND board. Chuck Hagel, the most recent, or the one of the more recent of the defense secretaries of President Obama, so the one who preceded his last defense secretary, he is on the board of RAND. A guy named Paul Kaminsky, who's considered by a lot to be the father of stealth technology, he's on the board at RAND. Malcolm Gladwell, who has written some newspaper articles that he's then turned into books, like The Tipping Point. You know, so there's a lot of different perspectives on the board. Their biggest customer is the government, the federal government. So that influences who they've got on the board. And then, yes, they do have business leaders. So I think you do have a lot of different perspectives coming to bear. But the most interesting thing about RAND are the presentations that the people at RAND give on the projects they're working on. I mean, that's the stuff that's fascinating. And incidentally, from business school, maybe you'll have the same experience I do, you know, years down the road, where if they want you to be on a board, their presumption is you're going to be on the audit committee. Oh, you've got a business degree from CMU. Okay, fine, you'll be good for the audit committee. I'm sorry, there's not an audit committee in the world that I think of. Actually, if an audit committee is exciting, you do not want to be on that audit committee. So it's not as if the committee work is what you're going to enjoy, right? It's got to be what the organization is all about that you enjoy. I'm also the chair of the Pittsburgh Cultural Trust. That's got mainly business leaders now, but there's a lot of community leaders on also. We've started the succession planning approach, and again, it's make sure that we go through a formalized structure, kind of a thin formalized structure, and then soft stuff around that. Hope that answered your question.
Thank you very much for your time and support.
Thank you. Thank you.
I just want to take this opportunity on behalf of all of our students and our faculty and administration. Thank you again, David, for being here, sharing those great insights about your career and the wonderful advice for our students as well. We greatly appreciate it. It's always nice for us to be able to host somebody who's from the local community as well. And despite the fact you're from the CMU of the West, we still appreciate you coming here. On behalf of our students and faculty and staff, we'd like to just give you a little token of the
day. Thank you.
And we appreciate it very much, you being here today.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you for coming as well.
Yes, thank you for coming.